You're listening to Interactive Wrestling Radio, featuring the Interactive Interview, courtesy of WrestlingEpicenter.com.
Hey guys, Anthony Carelli here, formerly known as WWE's Santino Marella, and you're listening to Interactive Wrestling Radio.
Well, hello there. Welcome to another edition of Interactive Wrestling Radio, right here on WrestlingEpicenter.com. Cheap pop, cheap pop. This week's guest is former WWE superstar Santino Marella. Hey, could you really ask for any more than that? One of the more popular guys in WWE of this millennium. Has his own Battle Arts Academy up in Canada right now, and you can check that out on Facebook as well as on Twitter. Just a all-around good guy, a great performer, and I think you guys are going to be hearing more from him in a lot of different facets based on what he says in this interview. I want to thank him for spending the time with us tonight. And I hope you guys enjoy this interview. Be sure and check out WrestlingEpicenter.com for 24-hour news updates. Check out the store. And also check out us on Facebook at Facebook.com/WrestlingEpicenter. So glad you guys decided to tune in this week. Stay tuned because we got two new interviews coming up next week. One with the TNA superstar and another one with a Lucha Underground superstar. So we're spanning the whole wrestling world right here at Interactive Wrestling Radio.
This is Impact Wrestling's Aaron Rex, and you are listening to Interactive Wrestling Radio.
If you want to conquer something, you must be ready for a war.
This is insane. Lucha Underground is out of this world.
Season 3. New episode Wednesday at 8 p.m. on El Rey Network.
Hey guys, how's it going? This is Amy Dumont, and you're in the Epicenter.
There was a boy who was told he was going nowhere. Crashing, clawing, rising, falling. Now he's a man, and he did what he said he would do. Rising, falling, never stop climbing. He saw it coming, he saw it coming. Even as a young boy, he saw it coming.
Welcome back to Interactive Wrestling Radio. On the Newsmaker line with me right now is the one and only former WWE superstar Santino Marella. How you doing today, sir?
Very, very good. Thank you so much.
We're so glad to have you on the show. Big fans of your work. You were a bright spot on the WWE programming for sure. So we're so glad to have you on the air tonight.
Thanks, man. It was a whole lot of fun, that's for sure.
All right. So you are now doing your own Battle Arts Academy, which is not just a wrestling school. You guys are teaching MMA, you're teaching judo, you're teaching a whole lot of stuff other than professional wrestling. How's that going? How's it been going for the last year or so?
It's going really well. I mean, we're almost at 3.5 years right now.
3.5? So, wow, see, I need to do my research.
Yeah, Battle Arts started while I was still on the road, and as my neck got worse, I was able to, it was kind of a blessing in disguise because I was able to stay home and, you know, help just focus on the gym a little bit in terms of getting the business. It was a huge undertaking and, you know, we have to generate a lot of money to pay the bills. So over time, we just increased our revenue. Like any new business, it takes a while, but now it's at the point where it's surviving, it's thriving, and we have champions in multiple arts. For example, we have a some national champions for kids and amateur wrestling, and we got some Muay Thai national and provincial champions, and we have, you know, our pro wrestling program is taking off. And my philosophy is for pro wrestling is to train like a professional athlete. So we have a lot of our pro wrestlers cross train. They do, you know, judo and boxing and all that kind of stuff. So they just have those real organic natural reactions and stuff. And it makes them better pro wrestlers. But it's like a miniature Olympic training center, 100%.
That's awesome. Now, you are a trained judo. In fact, you were the national champion of Canada, am I correct?
Yeah, that was a long time ago. So I stepped away from judo for my whole wrestling career. But now, since I'm kind of retired from WWE in July, I've been coaching again. I just came from another practice tonight, actually, where we're taking some of our young fighters to other clubs to get more sparring in and stuff like that. So it's fun, man. I never saw myself as a coach, but I'm definitely enjoying the role.
Absolutely. One of our recent guests was Ken Anderson, Mr. Anderson, Mr. Kennedy. And he takes a little bit of a different approach with his school. He teaches acting as well as wrestling. Yours is obviously more of a fighting arts, obviously by the name, obviously.
Yeah,
I guess there's everything.
Promo stuff.
Oh, sorry again?
So we also do promo work and improv work, totally, yeah.
Absolutely. So you kind of have to have the whole package these days with the way the wrestling product has evolved, don't you?
100%. Sometimes I have students that, you know, they're getting it. They're getting the showmanship and the psychology, but they have to become bodybuilders. You know, everybody has a different prescription on what they need to do to have success. And definitely some guys, they can wrestle, they have this, they look great, but they can't act for shit. So that's tough, you know. So everybody has a different prescription, but you have to have so many different hats when you're a professional wrestler. You know, you have to be a theatrical actor, you have to be a bodybuilder, you have to be a fighter, you have to be just an athlete, a showman, a role model, either a hero or a villain. There's so many different things to work on.
Absolutely. So we talked a little bit about promos just then, and I wanted to tell you about our little story about our show. We've been around a while, and when you came in, you were kind of you were supposed to be a heel, but you were so funny that the crowd started cheering you. Did you ever get flack for being so funny that the crowd started to, you know, like you?
No. The number one thing is that the crowd is making noise. You know, if they're quiet, that means they don't care. So if they're making noise, whether they're laughing or cheering or booing, that means they care and they're interested. And that's what the office wants, the audience to be engaged and interested in the product. So, you know, they let the audience organically turn me into a baby face. And really, my character didn't change very much. Just the person standing in front of me became a bad guy instead of a good guy. And it was when the audience changes you, it's so much more impactful than when the office changes you.
Absolutely. I agree with that. That actually was going to be my next question. As a former co-host of mine said that the WWE figured out you were funny, so started writing too many lines for you. Did you always come up with your own stuff, or was there always pointers as well to what to do, or how did that work out for your comedy lines?
Yeah, well, it went on a sliding scale. So in the beginning, it was very written, and then near the end, it was written very little. And, you know, as I just started owning my character and bringing it to life in my own unique way, they had more trust in me. And, they let me kind of say things the way I would say them instead of writing them specifically for me. So definitely there was a shift.
To this day, when people run into you on the street, are they surprised to hear that you don't have the Italian accent?
Yeah, all the time. I feel bad because they're so disappointed, you know, that I'm not as funny and goofy as Santino, but this is me. I'm Anthony, you know.
That's right. So the one guy, I've had Randy Savage on the show, I've had Hulk Hogan on the show, we've had a lot of guys on the show over the years. The one guy I never had on the show was a guy that you worked with on Jimmy Kimmel. And man, it was giving me flashbacks to TNT when he popped you. Lord Alfred Hayes took a smack back then, and you took a smack then. I guess, what was it like working with the great Roddy Piper? And also, who slaps harder, Roddy Piper or Jim Cornette?
Oh, Jim Cornette's like a woman. Roddy Piper definitely heard her. Yeah, you know what? Roddy Piper was, it wasn't so much working with him. It was like in between takes or just the discussions and the knowledge and the, he was just an awesome human being. I actually can't even believe he's gone. Every time I'd see him, he just genuinely would receive you so well and be interested and ask you what questions about yourself. And he was just a class act, man. I mean, he's not one of those guys just because he passed away, I'm going to pretend he was awesome. He was awesome.
Absolutely. Even though I never interviewed him, I talked to him a few times and he always made me laugh. So, I mean, that was a tough pill to swallow when we lost him.
Yeah, well, it was for sure. He was beloved by many.
Absolutely. Well, speaking of somebody who's loved by many and is going to be getting her just desserts, I think, heavy rumors, if not confirmed, is that Beth Phoenix, somebody who was heavily involved in your career, is going to be going into the WWE Hall of Fame. Are you surprised that she's going in so young?
No. She really, really changed the division, and she kind of sent it in a new direction to where it is today, where you have these girls that are not just beautiful, they're powerful, they're smart, they're and they are, of course, beautiful, but they're technical and they can wrestle. Beth Phoenix was one of the best wrestlers on the roster, guy or girl. But at the time she was wrestling, there wasn't a lot of girls that could go with her, maybe Natty Neidhart at the time. And she made other girls look like they were, you know, in a legitimate fight. That's how good she was. She was a great worker, superb athlete, loves the business. She was really a pioneer, you know.
Absolutely, absolutely. And she was a big part of your character for a little while there, so very much.
Oh,
so.
We had so much fun doing the whole gender role spoof and everything. It was awesome. Beth's a professional. I'm so proud of her.
I do my research, and one of the things I watched before we did this interview was the Hannibal TV interview that you did, and you kind of seemed like you weren't too thrilled with your Santina Marella character.
Santina?
Santina.
Oh, yeah. I mean, whatever. I knew it was going to happen. So my philosophy is if you're giving lemons, you know, you make lemonade. So they gave me that role, and I like to believe I knocked it out of the park, and then because it was supposed to be one night only, but it was so funny that I ended up doing it for 3 months. So I think 3 months. But it definitely tested my acting ability, that's for sure.
Well, I'm going to ask you about your acting in just a minute. But we talked a little bit about Santina, and you were fired by our president, the president of the United States, Donald Trump.
Can you believe that? That's crazy.
I know at the time that you did the Hannibal interview, you said he was getting popular, but man, he's the president of the United States now. I mean, what does that mean to you to think that, you know, the leader of the free world once fired you?
Yeah, well, you know, it makes me think that the revelations in the Bible are coming true, and there's going to be a World War III coming our way. I don't know, man. The political landscape these days is really scary and unstable, and I just hope it smooths over, man.
Oh, I hope so, too. I think the whole world, no matter what you think of Trump or anybody, everybody just needs to calm down. Calm down,
yeah.
And let and both sides. Just chill out, and let's try and work together, because this is where we're at. Back on point. Puerto Rico, Elimination Chamber. You were almost world champion. We interviewed Lance Storm many, many moons ago. Gosh, it's got to be 11, 12 years ago now. And he talked about the night that he almost won the world title in WCW and how it meant everything just to think that the people thought he could. I kind of think that might be your similar sentiments with yourself.
Yeah, man, that night when I came through the curtain, there was, you know, it's not often you get standing ovations in Gorilla, but there was a standing ovation. And I remember Cena came up to me and he was like, I know what I'm capable of, and I'm not going to be able to get them louder than that night. And that meant a lot to me. And when I watch it back, it's, you know, you're so in the moment, and you don't hear the audience completely because you are in the moment. But when I look back, it was awesome, man. It was electrifying.
Absolutely, absolutely. Now, got to ask you about the Cobra.
Yeah.
We've had guys that have had similar things. You know, we've had Sacco and Perry Saturn with Moppy and all that kind of stuff. When you first started doing the Cobra, did you think it would become as huge as it became?
You know what? It kind of took off really fast, so I didn't have a chance to really think about it. I mean, the reactions were immediately really good at live events and to the point where the word got out to TV. So then Vince wanted to see it and stuff. So then, it honestly blew up so fast. And I remember just being amazed at people, like the reactions when I make the gesture that I was going to pull it out. They'd go crazy. And I was just like, I didn't get it almost. You know, I'm like, why do you guys love this so much? It's silly. But they did.
Absolutely. Now, we talked a little bit about your acting career. You had the opportunity to do a movie in Wiggle All the Way 2. You've done some voice work for some of the Scooby-Doo movies that the WWE has done. In fact, Justin Walmart today, I don't think you're actually in the movie, but Surf's Up 2, you're paired in with one of the DVDs, your action figures.
Yeah, I heard someone else mention that, but at Walmart, I'm paired up with a movie. I don't know why.
I have no idea why. I kept looking at it thinking, I don't think he's in it, but that's cool. All right, so what was it like, you know, working with WWE Films, and how did you, I'm a voice acting aficionado myself. I respect the hell out of that art. What do you think of the option of doing that?
I do, actually. I just signed up with an agent at the end of the year to explore just acting, you know, making cameos, small roles, big roles. I don't care. I'll do whatever. I enjoy acting a lot. And as far as pro wrestling goes, I was probably more on the acting side of pro wrestling because I was playing such a different character than my personality. The experience was awesome. Larry the Cable Guy was awesome. You know, I would always... I almost swore. That's my story.
That's okay.
I would bother the WWE studios and say, you know, I have this idea for this film. I want to be in this film, and they keep me in mind. So when the opportunity came up, they kept me in mind and they called me for this role. And it was interesting because it was a role that it was a role where I had to be like calm, you know, like not as lively. So I thought that I could have had a more demanding role in terms of playing a character, but it was actually kind of harder to play a smaller character, if you know what I mean, like not someone that's so over the top and just a regular guy. That was kind of hard because I've always been so extreme in being Santino, so that had to it was challenging, but I felt my comfort from day one of filming to the end of filming just, you know, grow exponentially. First day I was nervous, by the end I was rocking. So that was the sentiment from WWE Studios and Michael Luisi. You know, the response back, even when I saw Vince, he's like, I heard you were nervous on day one, but I heard you really got comfortable and knocked it out of the park for the remainder. So I love it. I love the fact that there's a movie and because it's seasonal, you know, every Christmas people are going to watch it from years and years to come. So that's really cool.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Now that you're out of WWE, they're kind of expanding with the network, the growth overseas, doing the UK tournament with rumors of tournaments in Mexico and Japan to follow. What's your opinion of seeing WWE kind of become the be-all and end-all of professional wrestling? Not that it wasn't already, but kind of really kind of conquering the entire globe.
I think it's great. As long as there's options, like, you know, you can go to the UK, you can go to Japan, Mexico, NXT, you can be on the road, 205, whatever it is. It gives a lot more opportunity. It's not competition in the pure sense of the word because it's all the same company, and competition is always good for the wrestlers, you know, to give them options to go to, especially high paying options. But I want Battle Arts to be the Canadian developmental one day, so head in the right direction to make that happen, you know.
Absolutely. And I guess how can fans find out more about Battle Arts?
Battle Arts, battlearts.academy.ca. you know, I post a lot of stuff in my personal social media stuff about Battle Arts. I'm always updating a schedule or posting a class, or if somebody wins, I'm posting. So you can follow my Twitter. It's Milan Miracle. I usually post battle art stuff, or on Instagram, it's on Milan Miracle. And, again, yeah, I use it a lot for battle arts.
All right, excellent. A couple last questions here for you, a little bit out of order. We recently had on Damian Sandow, Aaron Rex, as he is now, and my kids were upset with me because I didn't ask him about something silly that he really didn't have anything to do with, which was Slam City. So I'm going to ask you about it, since you were one of the characters that they used on Slam City. What did you think as a WWE performer of hearing another guy do your voice and the, you know, the cartoon goofiness that was the Looney Tunes era of Slam City?
Yeah, I don't know. It was interesting. I mean, I didn't know why they didn't call me, but I don't know if anybody does their own voices or not.
No, it was all. I think it was all the same dude doing all the voices.
Ah, okay. It was cool. You know what? Like, anytime you're shown in a different format, like I have a like a Lego version of me.
Right.
That's a cool toy. There's like, you know, there's action figures, but there's all different types of action figures, like bobbleheads and all these different things. And every time I see something in a different format, it's so cool. Like the Scooby-Doo cartoon, Slam City, there's all different formats. I was even on a lighter in a gas station in Texas once. There's a Santino lighter, and that was cool, you know?
That's true. Yeah, you had there was a Roddy Piper one. In fact, I got one like 5 feet away from me hanging on the wall right now. So from that same set of lighters, yeah, there was a lot of stuff that WWE does. They are the marketing geniuses. Before I let you go, the last question I have for you is, I live in Arizona, and we got a lot of wrestlers that come through here, live here, but the one who's been here the longest is the guy you almost beat the record of for the Intercontinental title, and that's the Honky Tonk Man. We had him on. Got to be a while ago now, again, 6 years maybe. And he said something along the lines of he wishes that you guys could have gone longer. I think that really had legs. And if there was one chance to, you know, to really push it over the limit, they should have done it then, but they didn't do it. What was your impression of working with the great Honky Tonk Man?
Oh, he was awesome, man. You know, he's a consummate worker, you know, so he knew that if there's an angle and there's mic
on and off the screen,
yeah, he was down to work together. Yeah, we were supposed to do that. We were supposed to have the title and get close to the record and maybe like not beat it, but like come, you know, like that's the story of Santino, right? Coming so close and never actually winning. So I thought that's what we were going to do, but then they changed their mind and it ended abruptly.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, I'm going to start letting you go. One last question did pop in my mind, and that is, what was the actual final straw? What was the last straw that kind of put you out of the ring for good?
Well, it was just my neck. It was just an accumulation. Like, it was slowly getting worse, and the flare-ups would be, you know, more frequently, and they'd last longer, and the good time wasn't... like, the good times were getting shorter and shorter, and then it just... It locked up, and then, you know, I get stingers and everything. One of my discs had calcified, and it was, like, right against my spinal cord. So, I was in danger, you know. And
so there was not, like, just one – there was not, like, just one move that did it to you. It was accumulation over time?
Accumulation, 100%, yeah. And then after I did the double fusion, the first surgery, the couple screws came out. So they had to go in after 3 months, take out all the hardware, all the titanium and stuff. So I think that kind of set it back. So because there was a little bit of a screw up, they gave me lots of time to heal and everything. And it just never got well enough to the point where I could come back and you know, compete at a high level in the ring, or perform at a high level, I should say.
Absolutely. Well, I wish you the best of luck with the school. I think I've heard great things about it, and you guys, you're even running shows, I hear, as well. So,
oh yeah, we got TV, we got shows. It's quite inside the gym. We have a little arena called the Don Koloff Arena where we do kickboxing, boxing events, pro wrestling events. It's a cool little 300 to 400 person arena, and it's very, very quaint, but it's a good show.
Absolutely. Well, I wish you the absolute best of luck with it, and I can't thank you enough for spending this time with us tonight.
Oh, man, the pleasure is all mine. Thank you.
All right. Hey, before I let you go, can I ask for one little favor from you?
Sure.
I usually start each audio show with, this is so-and-so, this is the guest of the week, and you're listening to Interactive Wrestling Radio. Do you mind doing that for me?
Sure, not at all.
Interactive Wrestling Radio is
yeah.
the name. Okay, and I'll count you down in 5,
okay.
4, 3, 2.
Hey guys, Anthony Carelli here, formerly known as WWE's Santino Marella, and you're listening to Interactive Wrestling Radio.
Awesome, man. One take. You'd be surprised how many people don't get it done in one take. I love it. Thank you so much.
They call me One Take Tony.
This is Bobby the Brain Heenan, and if you're smart like me, you'll be listening to Interactive Interview. I do all the time.
Enjoying what you're hearing? Be sure and check out WrestlingEpicenter.com on social media at Facebook.com/WrestlingEpicenter. On Twitter at James Epicenter. And of course, WrestlingEpicenter.com for 24-hour news updates, our interview archives, and all the other information you've come to expect from the Wrestling Epicenter.
Welcome back to Interactive Wrestling Radio. We're so glad to have you. I promise you, I really haven't fired Patrick. Patrick just was not available this week again, so it's going to be me, James Walsh, just talking to you for a few minutes here about the current goings on in professional wrestling. Give you my perspective, because I think I usually try and give you a different view on things. First of all, let's talk a little bit about the Royal Rumble. The Royal Rumble just happened on Sunday, and there was no real big surprises. None. No returning legends, no real shocking debuts, really nothing special. And the winner was Randy Orton, who really hasn't done squat in 6 months. So everybody's telling me how great this Rumble was. I think these are the same people who like new records by people just because they're new. I'm sorry, but it's not true. This was not a great Rumble. This was okay. I don't know. Maybe it's just me. Maybe I'm too cynical, but I just didn't think it was that good. And for those who enjoyed it, well, good for you. But you're easier to please than I am, I guess. Also, Samoa Joe made his debut, and much like when he made his debut in NXT and almost killed Tyson Kidd, the guy he debuted against, Seth Rollins, is out of action. So... You know, if these guys had a death match, it might actually be a death match. Because Seth Rollins ended Sting's career, put Finn Balor out, exploded John Cena's nose, and Samoa Joe debuted and damn near killed Tyson Kidd, and now he's taking Seth Rollins out. Oh, man. Oh, man. Remember when you actually had an art to wrestling where you actually didn't hurt your opponent? I'm just saying. And finally, for my subject for the week, Lucha Underground. You always see that we run commercials for Lucha Underground on this show. If you ever wondered why, it's because I like it. And much like the music that you heard on this show today, Jack Russell's Great White and Stephen Piercy, the reason why you hear those is I like it. And what I do is I go to the people and I say, hey, can I use some of your stuff? And they usually say, sure. And Jack Russell did the same thing for me, so thanks to Jack for that. And we also got clearance from Frontiers Records to use Stephen Piercy stuff. That's why we used it. That's the same reason we run Lucha Underground commercials. We like what they do, so we promote it. That said, I am really, really, really worried about the future of their product. It's one of my favorite things to watch. One of the few wrestling shows the family will actually sit down and watch with us because it's got big, unique characters and incredible athletes, really. I mean, if you strip it down, it's... big characters and incredible athletes, and good stories for the most part. Kurt Bauer being involved is a negative, a massive negative. The guy ran his company ass backwards or back asswards, and that's MLW, by the way, and was a writer for WWE and not exactly their greatest time. So why would you, with that track record, say, hey, I need that guy working for my company? But anyway, they are now on a hiatus. They've been on a hiatus since mid-January. And it's not good because they're going to be off until May, which is earlier than I had originally heard. I had originally heard it wouldn't be back till July or August. Now it's May, which is at least it's early summer, but it's still too long of a hiatus for a show that was going strong. And they didn't obviously have this planned. They ended the mid-season finale with Matt Stryker saying something along the lines of, and next week we're going all night long. Well, next week, they're not doing nothing because they got just best of shows, Aaron. Now, I know a lot of this has to do with restructuring backstage and also their TV deal and their distribution deal. They recently signed with Netflix to get more eyeballs on the product. But I'm going to warn now, they cannot give up a TV deal. I don't care how much we want to pretend we live in the future. We don't. TV is where it's at. It's where the most eyeballs watch television. Yes, Netflix is great, and yes, Netflix is great, especially for the people who don't get the Array network outside of the U.S., inside the U.S., and maybe your cable or satellite provider doesn't carry it. Get as many eyeballs on the product as you can, absolutely, but do not give up the TV deal. Otherwise, you are going to very much hinder yourself. It's just my opinion. I think they're going to be all right, but I worry about some of the decisions that are being made right now. But I worry because I care. And I really do care. I know I said finally, but final thought on TNA Impact Wrestling. How great is it to see them back to doing tapings regularly and seeing that these shows are getting a little bit better each and every week? Can't really express how happy I am to see the Hardy Boys doing the traveling tour that they're doing and taking cameras with them. So it's not just Jeff Jarrett's idea for Global Force Wrestling was forming a global partnership with all the companies in the world that are not WWE bitches. Sorry, Evolve, that does not qualify you. And because your guys are bitches. Long story short, what they're doing now with the Hardy Boys is they're kind of bringing that idea into TNA, which obviously is probably a Jeff Jarrettism, to forming partnerships with Maryland Championship Wrestling, with CWF, Mid-Atlantic, all these other companies. They're making relationships with them. They're going to be airing some of that footage on Impact Wrestling. Look, we can't just have WWE. The most dangerous thing NXT ever did was convince people that that's the independents and somehow independent and separate from WWE. It's not. It is a WWE product. You know how I know that? Because you watch it on the WWE Network. Now, there's nothing wrong with WWE. I know I'm critical of it. But it's not my cup of tea. It hasn't been for quite some time now. If you enjoy it, again, you're easier to please than I am. And that doesn't mean that I'm being a sarcastic asshole. It just means that I don't enjoy it. If you enjoy it, fine. But I just think you need more than one choice. And pretending that something is a choice when it's not is not. You can put Diet Coke in a clear glass and call it something else. It's still Diet Coke in a clear glass. Anyway, that's my segment for the week. We got two interviews next week. Both of them are guys with initials. I'll leave it at that. One of them is from Lucha Underground. I think you know his phone number. And the other one is from TNA Impact Wrestling. Bro. Hope you guys enjoyed this interview, and thank you again for tuning in to Interactive Wrestling Radio right here on WrestlingEpicenter.com. Once again, check us out. Give us a like on Facebook at Facebook.com/WrestlingEpicenter, as well as check us out daily for 24-hour news updates, and always check out the store because we need the money. Thank you, guys. Stay tuned.
This is the Superfly Jimmy Snuka. Thank you for having me on your radio dial.